Here we'll be looking at the model that has been used to predict the steady state rate of spread of fires. It was developed originally by Rothermel in 72, and since then it has been used by several authors and very much the basis of lots of efforts for fire modeling, especially in this Behave Plus system that has been widely used in the US and in many places in the world. The typical inputs for these models are fuel characteristics like bulk density, fuel depth, surface area to volume ratio of the particles, and particle density. Also, some other variables that are more variable, like moisture content of the fuel. You have also to provide an estimate of the moisture of extinction, the mineral content, the low heat content, and then you can also use the system with different wind speeds and slopes. This system will provide some intermediate results. Packing ratio, fuel loadings, etc. They are all part of the Rothermel system for modeling fire spread, but they are combined to provide three major outputs: reaction intensity, first one, then the no wind, no slope rate of spread, and the predicted rate of spread if you incorporate wind and slope. So to start with, you can start looking at the effect of bulk density. And bulk density is a very important characteristic of the fuel. Here you see how reaction intensity and rate of spread are changed with different values of bulk density. So for very low values of bulk density, you have not enough fuel to really develop a very fast fire and a very intense fire. With higher values of bulk density, you don't have enough oxygen to be used in combustion. So you have typically incomplete combustion, and that's what justifies also this decreased rate of spread and decreased intensity. So we have kind of an optimal value of bulk density that can be used to in our modeling approaches. Okay, so here you can change bulk density. You start with 20 kilograms per cubic meter, but if you increase it, you can see what is the change of this increase in bulk density on reaction intensity and also in rate of spread. So rate of spread is now 21 meters per minute. If you increase your bulk density, you'll be decreasing your rate of spread because you are already in this decreasing part of the graph. Okay, so you can also see what is the effect of fuel depth. You can increase or decrease. Of course, when you increase the fuel depth, reaction intensity will increase because you have essentially more fuel for the same bulk density. And also you can see what is the difference with different surface area to volume ratios. So what you see here, for instance, is that when you decrease the value of the surface area to volume ratio, what you are having are typically larger fuels, and with larger fuels, the effect of bulk density is not so pronounced. So there are lots of possibilities to explore the different combinations of these variables. Of course, if you, again, now go back to some lower values of bulk density, but then if you are changing the moisture content, If you are increasing the moisture content, of course, you'll have a decrease in the reaction intensity and the rate of spread. And eventually, after a certain value, and you see we are 20% moisture content, it means that we are getting very close to the 30% moisture of extinction, and so practically rate of spread is minimal, and so fire will not be sustained. So you can see the effect of moisture content on the process. You can also look at mineral content. Of course, with higher mineral content, you have also a certain decrease in reaction intensity and rate of spread. Also, the limit of content, you can play with it. But then we can look at the effects of wind speed, for instance, at mid-flame height. And so instead of zero, and now we have 0.4 meters per minute of the no wind, no slope rate of spread, and the same predicted rate of spread because we have no wind. But so now we could start with some wind. If we start with some wind, what we have is that the predicted rate of spread is much higher than the reference rate of spread. Here you see the predicted rate of spread is this one. The no wind, no slope rate of spread is this one. So it follows the same general pattern with bulk density, but there is a major difference when you have wind speed. Of course, this is a very high wind speed, 19 meters per second, but even so, if you get to zero, the two curves are the same. If we increase a little bit the wind speed, even in 1 meter per second, then you almost duplicate the, well, this is a logarithmic scale, you increase dramatically the wind speed from 0.4 to 3.7 meters per minute. And you can also do the same with slope. If we increase the slope, you are also increasing your rate of spread. But it's not so dramatic as when you increase wind speed. With wind speeds, the values are quite different. So this was a possible way to have first estimates of rates of spread and reaction intensities based on these input variables that are the same that are used in the rotor mill systems in BEHAVE. So this is, let's say, a simplified version of BEHAVE, but I think it illustrates very well the importance of some variables like bulk density, and by playing with different numbers, you can have a feeling for what are the important variables and what are those that are not so important to assess, and that you can use reference values and not be very much concerned about getting the real value for that variable.